historically in the Navy, when the captain's out walking around, we're looking for sailors screwing off so that we could reprimand them. Well, learning from William Perry, I decided, why not find them doing something great so that I could thank them for their hard work and dedication? So instead of searching for sailors not doing great things, I actively looked for people that were doing above and beyond the call so that I could give them a pat on the back and thank them for their hard work and dedication. I don't get to motivate sailors by giving them bonuses or giving them pay raises. I don't get to promote them. And so how do you motivate people when you can't give them bonuses? Well, catch them in the act of doing something great. Thank them for going the extra mile. I do have one form of formal recognition I can give a sailor. They're called Navy Achievement Medals. They're important to sailors because if they get one, they get a bonus point on their advancement exam. I'm authorized to give out 15 of these medals a year. So I'd walk around the ship with medals in my pocket. And if I caught a sailor doing something great, I'd put a medal on his or her chest right on the spot. Thank them for going the extra mile. As I told you, I'm authorized to give out 15 of these medals a year. I figured nobody at the Bureau of Naval Personnel was tracking how many medals I was giving out. And my first year in command, I gave out 115 Navy Achievement Medals. And I figured I'm never going to get fired for recognizing outstanding performance. That's how you get more of it. But since we have two Army officers here, I want to share this story. It's a good story. I'm not going to slam you, don't worry. Although I could, I'm not going to. But I wanted to tear down this tree that had sprung up on our ship. And when we're at sea on weekends, we take Sunday afternoons off and we have a cookout on the flight deck. And I go back to my first cookout, whole long line of sailors waiting to get their lunch. And my officers would come up one by one and cut to the head of the line. And then when they got their lunch, they'd go up to the next deck up and sit up there by themselves. And, you know, my officers weren't bad people. We've done this for 237 years. We probably inherited it from the British Navy. I'm not sure. But when I worked for the Secretary of Defense, I got to accompany him around the world. And whenever I saw a best practice in action, I'd write it down. And one day we're at an Army base. And I noticed all the Army officers were going to the end of the line. I went up to one and I said, hey, what's up with this? I said, in the Navy, officers go to the head of the line. He said, in the Army, officers go to the end. That way, if we run out of food, it's the officers who go without, not the people on the front line. And I started thinking, what a simple but powerful signal we send to our people, that we put them first. And so instead of cutting to the head of the line, I go to the end of the line. I'm standing there, the officers are on the upper deck looking down on me, not knowing what to make of me. They send the supply officer to come down and talk to me. And he came down and said, you don't understand how things work on this ship. Officers go to the head of the line. I said, thanks, Suppo, I understand that. But I want to show this crew that they come before me. I'm here to help them get their job done better. And if we run out of food, I'll be the one to go without, not them. And when I got my lunch, I stayed down on the flight deck with the crew. Never said another word about that incident. Following cookout, my officers go to the end of the line. When they get their lunch, they stay down on the flight deck with their people. Now, my officers weren't bad people, because none are. They just never had anybody to show them how you interact with the people on the front line. And part of leadership development is trying to understand how we show up to the people we're trying to lead.